turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God. Our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Good morning. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Welcome to worship as we are gathered together to hear God's word, to receive the gifts that he gives in Holy Communion, to celebrate and give thanks for all the ways that our God blesses us and pours his grace into our lives. Immediately after the service today, there will be Bible study up here and Sunday school downstairs. The Bible study up here is working our way through the book of Romans, and it is a very interesting study, and so I'd like to invite you to participate in that after the service. For those of you who are worshiping online, if you would like to have curbside communion today, that is available, but I just ask that you call or text ahead of time to let me know that you're coming so that I can be out there for you. The number that you need for that is in the weekly news that can be found on the church website. Melissa Wheeler. Melissa, will you raise your hand so that everybody can see who you are? Melissa has brought some tomato plants, sweet pepper plants, and hot pepper plants. And if you would like to take some of those plants home for your own garden, you are welcome to do so. Melissa will be right out here at her car after the service, and you can get some plants and jumpstart your garden or add to your garden or wherever you are in the gardening process this year. So that will be available after the service as well. Our order of service is projected on the screens. Please stand for words of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Christ is risen. He is victorious over the powers of sin and death. He did not come into the world in order to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Therefore, let us come to him now to confess our sins, knowing that he hears and forgives. Gracious and merciful God, we confess that while we have been made new creations through the waters of our baptism, we still live ensnared by sin and are unable to free ourselves. We have not always lived our lives in accordance with the identity that you have given us in Jesus. We have not always done the things that you have called us to do. We have not always loved you above all else and with all our hearts, souls, minds, and strength. We have not always loved our neighbors as ourselves. Forgive us all our sins. Renew our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, so that our lives would show the identity you have given us in baptism and the new creations that you have made us to be. Amen. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he performs amazing deeds. He remains loyal and faithful to us. All the ends of the earth see our God deliver us. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated. in peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all of God's holy and dearly loved people who offer now their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of all creation. Blessing, honor, and might be to God and the Lamb forever. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. For the Lamb who was slain has begun his reign. Alleluia. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O King of glory, Lord of hosts, uplifted in triumph far above all heavens, leave us not without consolation, but send us the Spirit of truth whom you promised from the Father. For you live and reign with him and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings of the day.
The first reading is from the first chapter of the book of Acts. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of persons was all in all about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit broke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. Now this man bought a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their own language, Akedama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, may his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection. And they put forward two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, you, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Christ has risen from the dead. God the Father has crowned him with glory and honor. He's given him dominion over the works of his hands. He's put all things under his feet.
The epistle reading is from the fifth chapter of the book of 1 John. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has a testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God had borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand. Alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. While I was with them, I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost, except the son of destruction, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself, that they also may be sanctified in truth. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. My friends, I greet you this morning in the name of our Savior, Jesus. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Today is the seventh and last Sunday in the season of Easter. Can you believe that Easter was already 7 weeks ago? Anyway, as we get toward the end of the season of Easter, we see Jesus' conversations that he had on Monday, Thursday evening, just moments and hours away from his trial, from his crucifixion, from his death. We saw in the last 2 weeks, or rather, we heard in the last 2 weeks, Jesus speaking words of comfort and assurance to his disciples, letting them know that even though their experience of life and ministry with him present will look different, he'll still be with them. Things are going to change. No longer are they going to spend all of the time with him, following him and listening to him and watching him the way they had in the past 3 years. Now they will experience his presence in a different way. It will really be his presence. He will really be there with them because he promised that he would be. But for them, it will be different. For them, it will be much more like how we experience his presence, as we too hear and believe and trust and hold on to his words when he tells us, I will be with you always to the very end of the age. And where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. So he is here with us right now. In the last Sunday of Easter, we hear the prayer of Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane. These are the words that he prayed to the Father in those moments before his arrest. And what we see and hear in this prayer is the heart of Jesus for his church, for his followers, for his disciples. And this prayer is prayed for the ones who are with him in that moment. And it is prayed for all those who would come after them as well. That means you and me, and all the Christians who come after us as well. When you see it in that light, it is really incredible that this is the prayer of Jesus in a moment that had to be absolutely agonizing. Knowing what is coming ahead, he in that moment prays for us, for his people, for his church. And in this prayer, we see the heart of Jesus for his church. We see what matters most to him. And what matters most to him, well, that should matter most to us as well. Now, our lesson for today is just a short part of that prayer. It's worth it to go back and read the whole thing in the 17th chapter of John's Gospel. But in the section of the prayer that has been assigned for today, we see Jesus talk about three things that are important in the life of the church. We hear him talk about oneness. We hear him talk about set-apartness, and we hear him talk about sentness. The first thing we hear him talk about is oneness, because the church is one. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. Now, sometimes we can get to thinking that oneness has to mean conformity. It means we have to all think the exact same way about all the exact same things. But the reality is that the people of God are made up from people all over the world and from all across history. And guess what? You're going to find some different opinions amongst that group. You know what they say, wherever there are two or three Lutherans, there are always four or five opinions. So the idea that Jesus can take a diverse group of people and make them one family in himself is an incredible and powerful working of our God. Right now in Bible study, we're working our way through the book of Romans. And one of the things that I appreciate so much about this particular study is the emphasis on the differences that existed between the Gentile Christians and the Jewish Christians. They really did have a lot of trouble getting along. It was incredible. And yet Paul's message to them consistently is that you are siblings, sisters, and brothers in Christ. And from a worldly perspective, there may be lots of differences, and those differences may be irreconcilable, but in the church, under the family of Christ, we are one. And we're better and stronger when we are together than we are when we try to do things on our own. And that makes sense, right? Two heads are better than one. Four hands lift things easier than two. That's not really a saying, I just made that up. But you get the idea. And so I, as an individual, have a relationship with Jesus. In him, I have been forgiven and adopted into God's family. You, as individuals, have a relationship with Jesus. In him, you have been forgiven of all your sins and adopted into God's family. So if you are members of the family of God, and I am a member of the family of God, then that means that we all together are siblings. And that oneness that exists in Christ, that far exceeds anything else that we might find as a difference or a reason to be separated. It is so important to Jesus that in the moments before his betrayal and arrest, he prays to the Father to ask that his church would be one. And indeed, that is what we are. He also prays that the church would be set apart. Now, the translation that we used didn't use the word set apart. It used the word sanctify. That's a fun word, but that's what it means. It means to be set apart. Sanctify means to be holy, and holy means to be set apart. So if you think about the temple or the tabernacle and the tools that they used in the services of the temple and tabernacle, those tools were set apart. They were set aside for use just in the services of the temple. You didn't use it at the temple and then take it home and use it for dinner. They were set apart for a holy task, for a special task. In our culture, it's kind of like the good china. You don't use the good china for everyday breakfast, lunch, and dinner. You use the good china for those important and special occasions. The day-to-day stuff doesn't happen. The good china is set apart. It's kind of holy in that sense, only coming out when necessary. God's church is sanctified. We are holy. we are set apart, not through any work of our own, but through the work of Jesus Christ and his perfect life and death and resurrection. Because on the cross, he won and purchased and redeemed you and me and all sinners, paying the price for our sins in full, winning peace with God for us, so that we live in that peace. And having forgiveness of sins and having peace with God, being part of God's family, we are then set aside, sanctified, made holy, for a special purpose. And that purpose is to join God in the work that he's doing in this world. You see, it might be tempting as we think about oneness and set apartness to think that that means that what we have to do is take ourselves out of the world, to protect ourselves from the influences of the world so that it can't undo the oneness or the set apartness that we have as the church. But if you notice in Jesus' prayer, he says, I don't ask that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. And just as the Father sent the Son into the world, so too the Son sends his church. So you can kind of think of it like this. We, together, as one family of God, we are set apart, we are made holy to know the forgiveness and mercy and grace and life and salvation that comes from our God in Jesus. We have this and experience it in our lives, and it touches our lives in such a way that it becomes the marks of our lives so that we live as people who are gracious and full of mercy and forgiving and who have hope. And we go out into the world so that others may hear and see and know what that is and what that looks like. This is the mission of God. It means we live our lives as his people wherever he has placed us, and that everything that we do is done as an act of worship. So as we love and serve and care for our neighbors and for one another, we are loving and serving our God. And in living lives in that way, we bear witness. We show the world around us what it means to live as the people of God. To live as people of hope. To live as people who have received much grace and mercy and forgiveness. You see, the church doesn't have a mission. God's mission has a church. And he sends us out into the world so that through us, others would know what we know. Now, it's not always easy. And we are not perfect. We will make mistakes, we will fail, we will get off track. But when we do, we can always go back to our God, confess our sins, know that he hears us and forgives us, that he renews us and restores us and sends us right back out into the world so that we can join him in what he is doing. And if that all sounds a little scary and overwhelming, then rest assured, because he gives you his Holy Spirit. And the Spirit will always give you the right words to say in the right moment. And will always let you know the right thing to do at the right time. Now, he doesn't let us know ahead of time. But in those moments when we are there and we need him, he works in us, among us, and through us. So let us live boldly, confidently, joyfully, as who we are, as God's people, the church, knowing that Jesus prayed this powerful prayer for us. And not only do we know that he prayed that prayer, but as we celebrate the ascension, which took place just this past Thursday, we know that even right now, Jesus is interceding, that is, praying for us now. And may that good news give us much hope and comfort and peace and strength as we live out our lives as God's people in this place. And as we do that, may God be glorified and may we be blessed now and always. Amen. We make confession of our faith in the words of the Creed. Please stand. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. If you are celebrating a birthday in the month of May, I invite you to remain standing. Otherwise, you may be seated. Let us pray. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, you have given us our bodies, souls, and all that we have. We thank you for the great gift of life that you have given to us, and especially to these, your dearly loved people. We thank you for them and for being able to share life with them. As they celebrate another year of life, we ask your blessing and favor to be upon them. Increase their joy in life lived with you. Grow their trust in your presence and promises, and give them zeal for joining you in your mission in this world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We give thanks for you and celebrate with you as you celebrate another year of life. And in this next year, may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Happy birthday. God bless you. Amen. I invite the rest of the congregation to stand now for the prayer of the church. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Christian Church, here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all those impacted by COVID-19, that wisdom and discernment would be given to leaders and medical personnel, that they may best know how to serve, protect, and care for the people under their authority. For protection for doctors, nurses, and all medical people working on the front lines of this pandemic. For mercy and healing for those afflicted by this disease, and comfort and peace for those who have lost loved ones to it. And for peace and comfort in God's presence and promises in these scary days, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Amen. We lift up this plate as a sign of the offerings that we give in the various ways that we give them throughout the week. Let us pray. Victorious God, Jesus defeated death in his resurrection. In your love and mercy, you have made us witnesses to this wonderful news. Help us to live lives of love and service to others that point our neighbors to Jesus and the hope that we have in him. Accept these offerings that we bring before you with thanksgiving and gratitude for all of your blessings and gifts to us. Use them for your glory and to further the work that you are doing in this place and all around our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he has destroyed death, and by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. God, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Amen. You may be seated.
shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you.
Christ, oh.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Thank the Lord and speak his praise. Tell everyone what he has done. Let all who seek the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He recalls his promises and leads his people forth in joy. With shouts of thanksgiving, Alleluia, Alleluia. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.